seats as just prepare to worship the Lord this morning.
Lives this house. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Almighty God, to you
all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Stirring up and inciting the crowd. Then the brethren immediately sent Paul off on his way to the sea, but Silas and Timothy remained there. Those who conducted Paul brought him as far as Athens and received a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him as soon as possible. They departed. This is the word of the Lord. The psalm appointed for this Sunday is Psalm 66. We will read it responsibly by half verse. Be joyful in God, all of you lands.
Sing the glory of his name. Sing the glory of his grace.
Say to God, how awesome are your deeds.
Because of your great strength, your enemies cringe before you.
All the earth bows down before you.
Sing to you, sing God your name.
Come now and see the works of God.
How wonderful he is.
He turned the sea into dry land, so that they went through the water on foot.
And there we rejoice in him.
In his might he rules forever. His eyes keep watch over the nations.
Let no rebel rise up against him.
Bless our God, you peoples.
May the voice of his praise be heard.
Who holds our soul in life? Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, it is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The second reading is from the book of 1 Peter. So put away all malice, and all guile, and insincerity, and envy, and all slander. Like newborn babes, long for the pure spiritual milk that it is by you may grow up to salvation. For you have tasted the kindness of the Lord. Come to him, to that living stone, rejected by men, but in God's sight, chosen and precious. Like living stones, be yourselves built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands in Scripture, Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious. He who believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, therefore, who believe, he is precious. But for those who do not believe, the very stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the cornerstone, and a stone that will make men stumble, a rock that will make them fall. For they stumble because they disobey the word as they were destined to do. You are your chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, that you may declare the wonderful deeds of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were no people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth and indeed in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ may be seen to us.
Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe in me also. For in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. Henceforth, you know him and have seen him." And Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and yet you do not know me? Philip, he who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me. Or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will be done, because I go to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Phrase is a "go and meet," which means I am the one. This is a very, very strong statement about personal identity. So I am the way, the truth, and the life. The context is the Last Supper. This is John chapter 14, and John chapter 13 is the washing of the disciples' feet. They're up in the upper room. And then in 14, 15, 16, and 17, we have a lot of talking going on. There's a lot of red ink if you have a red Bible where Jesus is speaking. And there's soliloquies, and there's teaching, and there's back and forth, and there's conversation while he's doing this. And so along the way, during this dinner, he says, oh, by the way, one of you is going to betray me. Oh, and by the way, all of you are going to deny me before the night's over. Oh, and Peter, you're going to deny me three times. I will die now. Three times. It's coming. Oh, and by the way, don't forget, I'm leaving you. I'm going to be gone. No problem. But let not your hearts be troubled. Let not your hearts be troubled. Right. I think one of the things that they were trying to get their head around was, I'm leaving you. It's almost like losing a parent. How many of you have lost a parent? Well, these hands go up. David the Fathom, who normally sits here, his mom passed away last Monday. You'll hear that in the prayers of the people. Catherine Warren will have her funeral here on the 30th at 11. When you're younger, maybe when you're older, but it happened to me when I was younger. I was 14. We were living in downstream. My dad was already up north, up near Buffalo, looking at a new job. We were going to move in 2 weeks. My mother was 42. The kids in the house were 14 down to 5. My grandmother, her mother, my mom's mother, was there with us. Everything was fine, getting ready to pack it up, moving. And my sister came in and said something's wrong with mom, and I went and thought she was gone. She was dead. Total shock. She had a massive heart attack. And I'm 71. And I can tell you it's not something you get over. Just live with it. Really is true. I was dazed, confused, I was in shock. I was out of my head. I was runt back in those days. Not that I'm worth of that now. I walked out of the house and I was walking around the block. And I looked up and there was the neighborhood bully. He had his bike. He spotted me. And I really was a runt. And he's kind of a big kid. And he steps up on that bike and just starts pumping really hard toward me. Wanted to run me off the sidewalk. And I planted my feet and I put my hands out and stopped. I didn't move an inch. And I flipped the bike and I jumped on top of him and I beat the crap out of him. I mean, it was bad. It was bad. He ran off running. I'm going to get my dad. I said, bring your brother. I mean, but I didn't know what I was to do. And here they are. I'm leaving you. Kind of brings up the idea of normal. What was normal for them? Normal was, we're all together, we're moving, we're going to go here today, we're going to see some miracles, and you're going to teach, and we're going to have a meal, and then off we go to the next place, and we'll do it all over again. That's normal. What do you mean you're not going to be here? What was their expectation? In Acts chapter 6, so when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, when at this time will you restore the kingdom to Israel? They still thought this was going to be a restoration of the kingdom. It's going to be just like it was with David. All the world is going to respect us. We're going to be top dog. It's going to be wonderful. But you're not going to be here. You hear me say that all anxiety is due to uncertainty. It was certainly true for the disciples. They did not know what was going to happen next. They were confused. Even when they went to the garden, they didn't really know what was up. You know,
It was very, very strange time. Later we've been talking about a new normal. And you heard me say, I hope that the new normal is not the old normal. We need a better normal. And all of that means, I'm not going to get into that, relationship with God or people, whether it's our family, ourselves, our community, our church, our country, whatever it might be, we're hoping for a better normal. Having gone through this together, think of something that's troubling you right now. Could be your family. Could be your finances. Could be your work, your job. Could be the country, the nation, the things that are happening in our nation that you've never experienced before. I don't care how old you are. Right now, I think, Jay, you're here. Hallelujah. Today, in the hands. See, in some circles, this act of bravery and bridal to being a POW. Although Red did say this was a family conversation, right? You're not sneaking under the radar. Okay, good. No matter what it is that's on your heart and on your mind and weighing you down right now, I can tell you, until Christ is sufficient for you, you will never be at peace. Until Christ is sufficient for you, you will never be at peace. That is a truism. I got in the mail a book from John Piper, The Coronavirus in Christ. Now, I got it free. Tom had to buy it. Decision magazine. And one of the things in there, he said, when life changes, he went to the doctor in 2009 and the doctor said, I'd like to, can I do a biopsy on you? And Piper said, when would you like to do that? He said, now. And he walked out of the room and Piper thought, my doctor thinks I have cancer. And then they did the biopsy and it came back and he had prostate cancer. And if you had asked him before this, how are you, John? He would say, I'm fine. He stopped saying, I'm fine, because he wasn't fine. He had cancer. The new response was, I'm feeling fine. I'm feeling fine. I've got this problem, but I'm feeling fine because Christ is sufficient. I don't know how many of you know Ravi Zacharias, a wonderful minister, evangelist, apologist, incredible, incredible guy. He just came back from MD Anderson in Houston. He flew back to Atlanta, and he's there to die because he has cancer and there's nothing more that they can do for him. I will guarantee you, if you ask him along this line, how are you doing, Ravi? He would say, I'm feeling fine. Because Christ is sufficient for Ravi Zacharias. And until Christ is sufficient for me and for you, we will never be at peace. So we need to keep that in mind. Now Jesus presents himself as the object of faith. He says, believe in God, believe also in me. Very bold statement, kind of equating himself with God. And in other places that gets him in trouble. When you read the Matthew, when he was on trial. And the high priest said to him, I adjure you by the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. Jesus said to him, you have said so. But I tell you, hereafter you will see the Son of Man seated on the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest tore his robes and said, he has uttered blasphemy. Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your judgment? They answered, he deserves death. Believe in God, believe also in me. God and I are kind of on the same plane here. It says, I go to prepare a place for you. William Barclay has a wonderful little story on that. The word I go is programon, hard to say it. Two uses of this word which light up the picture within it. One, in the Roman army, the prodromoi were the reconnaissance troops. They went ahead of the main body of the army to blaze the trail and to ensure that it was safe for the rest of the troops to follow. And the second example he gives of that word is the harbor of Alexandria was very difficult to approach. When the great corn ships came into it, a little pilot boat was sent out to guide them along the channel into safe waters. That pilot boat was called the Prodromos. It went first to make it safe for others to follow. That is what Jesus did. He blazed the way to heaven and to God that we might follow in his steps. He has gone before us to make that way possible, open, and safe, because unless he had made that way open, it wouldn't be. We used to get pilots all the time in the Navy and just thinking of one. The only one I remember, I was in Iceland. We were pulling into Reykjavik. And in the 70s on a ship. And it was this little old man, beard, old guy, and I was talking to him. And I said, what's the warmest it's ever been in your life? And he said, once when I was a boy, it was 21 Celsius. Now what is 21 Celsius, roughly? 70 degrees. Once, when I was a boy, it was 70 degrees. I just thought that was amazing. He was a guy who would bring you in and out of these harbors, these treacherous little narrows. And that's what this was all about. Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you. And then Jesus says, or Thomas says, wait a minute, how do we know where you're going? We don't know the way. Where are you going? We always think of doubting Thomas. He wants to put his hands in the runes and all that. But it was Thomas, when Jesus is getting ready to go to raise Lazarus from the dead, he says, all right, come on, we're going to go see Lazarus. And the rest of the disciples say, are you crazy? The last time you were there, they tried to kill you. You just escaped within an inch of your life. You want to go back there? What? And Thomas says, let us rise and go and die with him. If he's going to die, we're going to die with him. But he asks the question. And I take that as a good sign. I love people who ask questions, good questions. The only bad question, dumb question, is the one that doesn't get asked, right? I will say to somebody, if I've given them instructions or asked them to do something, they'll say, what did I tell you to do? Tell me what I told you. Tell me what you think I said I want you to do. And to tell you, and sometimes it's right, and sometimes it needs a little tweaking. Better to tweak it before it's done wrong than wait until after it's done. So he asks a good question. He's got some courage there because a lot of people say, well, I don't want to ask a question because I don't want to look stupid. Well, ask a question. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. Thomas a Kempis, he was a wonderful medieval monk. 14th century. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. Without the life, there is no living. I am the way which you should pursue, the truth which you should believe, the life which thou should hope for. Someone said, I'm wandering about. I don't know where I'm going. Jesus is the way. Stanley Jones told of a missionary who lost his way in an African jungle. He could find no landmarks, and the trail vanished. Eventually, stumbling on a small hut, he asked the native living there if he could lead them out. Liam and I were, about three Saturdays ago, we're going to play golf on a Saturday morning. I play about maybe once a year. And I played with Jim Wilkerson, and he can attest to my skills. So we went over to baseline. And it started to rain. We had played four holes. We had signed up for nine. So now we have to go back to the clubhouse. Neither of us had ever been on this place before. We could not find it. We're going down fairways and up and down on hills and sand traps and asking people where to go. And they're pointing and we go. And it's not the way. It took us about 20 minutes to find the clubhouse. But we finally got it. Where the guy said, how many holes you play? Four. He says, oh, by nine. Play three, you bought the round. Tough luck. Anyway. The native nodded, rising to his feet, he walked directly into the bush. The missionary followed on his heels. For more than an hour, they hacked their way through a dense wall of vines and grasses. The missionary became worried. Are you sure this is the way? I don't see any path. The African chuckled and said over his shoulder, Juana, in this place there is no path. I am the path. I am blazing this trail. When you follow me, you're on the path. When you follow Jesus, you're on the path. Someone said, I'm confused. I don't know what to think. And Jesus said, Jesus is the truth. I always say, lying is the intent to deceive. The ship captain one day recorded in the ship's log, first mate drunk today. It was a true statement, but it was the first incident where the mate had been drunk while on duty. The mate pleaded with the captain to amend the statement, but the captain refused, saying it was a true statement. The next time the first mate was in charge of the ship, he recorded in the log, Captain sober today. It's a true statement, but what does it lead you to believe? Most of the time he's drunk. Whoa, he was sober today. Haven't been drinking. Somebody says, I'm dead inside and I don't know if I can go on. Jesus is the life. He says, no one comes to the Father but by me. No one comes to the Father but by me. It sounds very exclusive. In fact, in Acts 4, Peter and John are in the temple. This is after the crucifixion, the resurrection, the ascension. They're in Jerusalem ministering. They go to the temple. They see the man that's been blind since birth. Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give you in the name of Jesus Christ. Rise and walk. He jumps up. He starts dancing around. Everybody's amazed, and they drag Peter and John before the Sanhedrin. These are exactly the same people that just convicted and crucified Jesus Christ. And Peter knows it. And he starts giving a sermon that would make your hair stand up. And at the end of it, he says, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Not a very popular position in a pluralistic society that we live in. Today, all beliefs have equal weight. Your truth is your truth. My truth is my truth. And I've told you the story before, but I like it, about a philosophy class where they had a young man in a freshman class, and he was all about, there is no absolute truth. Your truth is your truth. My truth is my truth. And that's the way it is. And so the professor would work with him through the semester, but to no avail. At the end of his term, there's a final exam. The kid gets his paper back, and he's flunked. Where he goes to the professor, I can't believe you failed me. I wrote a good paper. And the prof says, oh, yeah, it was the best one I got, actually. It was the best paper you got? Yeah, it really was. Well, why'd you fail me? Well, you put it in a blue folder. What? Yeah, I don't like blue folders. You put it in a blue folder, you failed. That's crazy. No. It may not be true for you, but it's true for me. You failed. Have a nice day. Does that make any sense? No, it doesn't. Did the kid's point of view make any sense? No, it doesn't. Nobody can live like that. If you went to a restaurant and you looked at the menu and you said, well, how much is this? I'll let you know when I bring you the bill. Oh, I don't think that's how this works. I want to know what this is going to cost me, you know? Yeah, honey, we're going to get married, but I'm going to date. Now, that may not be true for you. But how would that work? I don't think that would work very well. Nobody can live that way. I think today it's fair to say that Christology is the battleground of the church. The uniqueness of Christ. Uniqueness of Christ, the authority of Scripture. In fact, Christ is the issue. You know, in the Episcopal Church, when you want to be a priest, you go to seminary. For the first 2 years, you're a postulant, and then you come back to your diocese. You meet with your vestry and director, and they recommend that you become a candidate for your final year at seminary. And then you have to go to the standing committee, who will then recommend to the bishop whether you should become a candidate. So these uprising third-year students or seniors would come, and I was the head of the standing committee for a while. And you'd interview them, and I had the same question. My question was, who is Jesus? And after hearing that this morning, Carolyn reminded me that when we were interviewing her to be our organist, she said that was your question. Who is Jesus? And she thought, doesn't he know?
Man cannot be saved by bread alone. Man cannot be saved by earning his way, by working his way. For by grace that he's saved, through faith, and that not of yourself. This is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. There is only one way that men can get to heaven. One road. Jesus said it's a narrow road. He said the gate was narrow. And it's the cross, and I must come to his cross. That's the reason that one-third of Matthew, one-third of Mark, that's the reason that one-half of John is given over to the death of Jesus Christ in Hayes' Life of Lincoln. There are 5,000 pages, and Lincoln was dramatically assassinated, but there are only 25 pages given to his death. Yet in the biographies of Jesus Christ, from a third to a half, are given to his death. Why? Because it's the only way to heaven. It is the only way to get forgiveness of sin. And if you haven't come by faith to the foot of that cross, renouncing your sins, I don't care who you are or what you are, you'll never be in heaven. You might be a member of some church. You might live a good, decent life, and all of that is fine. But your sins are not forgiven, and you're not going to heaven unless you come by the way of that cross. Have you come for the way of that cross yet?
The only way that earth can ever find reconciliation with heaven is by way of the cross. The only way that you can ever get to heaven is by way of the cross. And if Jesus Christ had not gone to the cross, you could have never had sin forgiven. You could have never gone to heaven. And the problems of earth would have never had a solution. Only by the way of the cross can we find our way back to God. And that's why it was important that Jesus stay on the cross. Because you see, man is in rebellion against God. Adam and Eve rebelled in the Garden of Eden. And every man since Adam and Eve has broken God's law and sinned against God. And as a result of that, God and man are separated. And man's only way back to God is through Jesus Christ.
No, if God didn't spare Jesus, he's not going to spare you if you don't know Christ. The only way that God can spare you and remain a just God is for you to come to Christ and let Jesus Christ come into your heart and forgive your sins. That's the only way God can do it. Sure, you have religion, but that's not going to save you. You are saved by Jesus Christ, by the blood that was shed on the cross, by his resurrection, by what is called in the Bible the kerygma, the story of Christ on the cross, when God took your sins and laid them on Christ, and he became sin for us who knew no sin. That's the only way anybody's going to be saved. I don't care who you are. No one is going to go to the kingdom of heaven except the way God said go. You might not like it that way, but that's the way it is.
The way of salvation has not changed. In all these centuries, the way of salvation is still the same. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, in Acts 4:12. John 14:6 says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. In the last generation, the only way to God was through Christ. In this generation, the only way to God will be through Christ. The only one in history of whom it is written, he that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Think of it. The wrath of God abides on you now. And the only way that wrath can be turned away is by the cross. When Jesus Christ took your sins on the cross.
Is there another way to heaven except through Christ? The Bible teaches there's only one way. Other people will come along and try to tell you there are other ways. But the Bible says there's only one way. And that way is by the cross. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. In the last generation, the only way to God was through Jesus. In the present generation, the only way to God is through Jesus. Jesus on the cross. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Then he said an interesting thing. No man comes to the Father except through me. That's the way to God, is through Jesus. In Acts, the 4th chapter, he says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we can be saved. You know, Buddha said at the end of his life, I'm still searching for truth. Jesus is the truth. He is the light.
You know, you see that, and that message he gave never changed along the way throughout the years of his ministry. I think of people like John Wesley and Charles Whitfield and George Whitfield, or Jonathan. I mean, people in our own early days of our same message throughout the history of the church, where you have that genuine message. God is present, God is real, God is powerful, God is active. But then there are those who reject it. And they say, I'm glad that works for you. Some people are satisfied with their own way of doing nothing. Doing the best they can, or they just say it's all nonsense. Born, you live, you die, you're food for worms. So much for that, you have to see a beady eye. Food for worms, Mark. Maybe you deny lostness. I'm not a sinner. I don't need a savior. So that's salvation by comparison. So you can say, at least I'm not as bad as Dave Riker. Or Pam Carson. Or somebody else there. Maybe you're convinced there's several valid ways to get to God besides Jesus. If you're in a burning building, you're going to go out the way at the door. You're not going to say, well, I can get out the second story of a door. I can drive over here. If there's a door here, then you're going. If you're flying somewhere, now let me just say, you may not remember this, but we used to have something called airplanes. And you would go to it was called an airport. And you would buy a ticket, and you would go on and get on an airplane, and they would fly you from one city to another in a short amount of time. It was amazing. And when they would get to the location, destination, they would be told what runway to land on. You didn't get to pick. United 814, 28 right. Wait a minute, is that Jeff, what are you here? Jeff Dahl is a Southwest pilot, actually, he's still flying. You remember what these are? Airplanes? They're still there? Now let me just ask you a question. Lately, when you're flying, are you flying? How many people on a plane? Sounds like zero on one flight. When's the last time you flew on a flight that wasn't full? And there hasn't been more crew members than passengers. All right. So when you're going into an airport, what kind of thing do you hear for the runway? What would it sound like? Okay, so that was pretty close. Southwest, 084, clear to land, 17 right. You know, and you don't say, I think I'll go left. I think I like 19 better. You don't do that, right? Okay. By the way, all that we'll get back. We're all going to fly. We're all going to get on airplanes. We're going to go places and do things that come up to you. I'm sincere. Well, the last one on that was a phone number. If I want to call Kathy, the phone company, makes me do the same, just those numbers. I don't get to pick random numbers if I want to get a hold of my wife. I have to dial those numbers. There's only one way. Ring her phone. I'm sincere. You know where that comes from? Sincere means without wax. You would have in Roman days, they would make pottery, and sometimes the pottery would break, and they would seal it on the inside with wax so that it was not exactly what you thought it was. So that they would have a sign, sincere, without wax, meaning it's the real deal. It's genuine. You can trust this. We're being honest here. We're not trying to put one over on you. Sincere. You can be sincere. You could be giving somebody poison and think it's real medicine, and they're not going to get well. You can sincerely write people checks when you have no money because you say, I must have money, I still had checks. Yeah. What's wrong with that? Adam got up and he walked this way. I thought he was coming for me, but it was okay. As the way, Jesus is our path to the Father. As the truth, Jesus is the reality of all God's promises. As the life, Jesus joins his divine life to ours. So, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in Jesus Christ, for he is the way, the truth, and the life.
Please stand as we affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom shall have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the Church and for the world, responding, hear our prayer. Almighty God, guide and strengthen, we pray, Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Bishop Vitalis, Bishop Peter, Jerry R. Griffin, and our clergy, Don, Tom, Ryan, John, Larry, Bob, Shirley, Karen, and Peg. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we ask your blessing on the peace of ministry in this parish. Bless Brian, Carolyn, Joel, and Margaret as they lead this vital means of worship. Lord, in your mercy. Grant your wisdom and discernment to all those who serve our country and community. For Donald.
mercy on you, forgive all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. May the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Come on.
difference is, when you guys were just looking on your own, you were all running around like chickens with their heads cut off, basically, right? You didn't know where to go or what you were going to do. But when I was able to show you where you needed to go, you found what you needed and what you wanted. Jesus is like that. When we're not following him, when he's not the way and the path, then we're kind of running around crazy. We don't know where we're headed, what's going on. If you follow him, you get it. Get where you're going. And you get what you need. Right? All right. Father, we thank you for these wonderful kids. We ask you to bless them as they go throughout their lives. Billy's having some back surgery, Judy's getting ready to have some knee surgery, and Molly got a horse fall on her. And a dog bite her. Did a bird do anything to you? Lord, we lift up Billy, you give a blessing, and we thank you that she's going to be able to get the surgery this week. Thank you for those who are performing it. We thank the Lord in advance. Successful, quick recovery, no complications. Thank you, Lord, for restoring your health and wholeness and value of the Spirit. Father, lift up Molly to you for the complete healing from this event as the horse did its thing with her. And pray that she heals well. Lift up Judy to the Lord that she had the surgery soon and that it would also be effective. Thank you. Oh, she is, right. This is this way. Yes. Coming up this way. Yeah. All right. Anyway, Lord, Janice, if you're watching, we pray for you. We thank you, Lord, that you've got a good team down there to do that surgery. So we thank you for the successful surgery and also pray for Janice's back gets healed. In Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Babe, lift back your seat. That money wise. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name, bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. With you.
And with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all. Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Please be seated, those who are taking food and drink, please come forward.
I know.
Let us pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father,
you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Blessed be God, Almighty.